we are going to talk about central vertigo or dangerous vertigo, where it is not always the ear. Generally, we, as a routine, when somebody complains of vertigo, one immediately tries to think this is due to the ear, and neurologists tend to relax when it is due to the ear because it's easy to just refer it to a ENT or to give some medicine. So let us focus on those disorders or those causes of vertigo where it is not due to the ear. I already told this case, but I'll just go over it again for those who missed. 65-year-old man with old left stroke. He was on aspirin and telmisartan, and one day in the morning he just woke up, felt dizzy. He tried to get up, go to the bathroom, and he felt dizzy, and he had to go back and lie down. Again, after 5 minutes, he tried to get up. Again, he felt dizzy. So he called his GP, and the GP, without listening to anything or even checking him, sent him, told him, you just go and get admitted. So this guy got admitted, and the CMO called me up, and the CMO was wondering, why has he got admitted? The blood pressure was 130 by 80, pulse was 110, maybe a little high, no neurodeficit. But on trying to stand or walk, the patient was feeling dizzy. So he called me, houseman called me up and said, should I do an MR angio or VHIT or VNG or what? And then, of course, you know the answer. The answer is check the standing blood pressure. So this person had postural hypertension. His BP fell to 90 when he stood up, and it was due to occult GI bleed. The malignant was seen only next day. He required almost 3 pints of blood over the next 3 days, and gastroscopy next day confirmed the gastritis. So you have to think of postural hypertension when it is acute or sudden in onset, or in without any reason when it happens. You must think of loss of blood. And when blood is not seen, it is either GIT loss or it may be in the large muscles. So somebody who's on anticoagulants suddenly gets postural hypertension, then he might be losing blood in the hip or thigh muscles. Let me put this guy to be quiet. Pico. Okay, I think it's going to be difficult. Okay, then this was a young boy with vertigo. 3 days ago, he had mild vertigo, no tinnitus or deafness. So again, looks relaxed, nothing, no symptom, just vertigo. And the GP gave him a combination of drugs. The patient improved and went for a picnic. And then 3 days later, the picnic...
Chakra manje kaya hota to?
Chakra manje sa saltana tuldas hota.
Kutla bada ba?
He also had numbness over the face. So what he had was a...
Sir, sorry.
He's young, he's not hypertensive, he has no risk factors. He has no other symptom or sign except sign, of course, he got later. But when he went to the GP, he had no other sign and the only symptom was vertigo. So you have to be careful. Remember, central vertigo is the cause in almost 1 out of 4 causes of dizzy patients. And depending on the type of practice, you may find it even more common. So you have to be very careful. Try to think of central vertigo either dangerous causes or benign causes. Sorry, let me just do something about Pico.
Pico.
Okay, so you have to think of dangerous causes or benign causes. So which are the most common dangerous causes? Most important is stroke, cardiac or circulatory causes like this guy with postural hypertension. If you had missed it, he could have been in danger of his life. Demyelination, multiple sclerosis can cause, and various tumors. When they are the cause of dizziness, it is dangerous. And these are the ones you must look out for. The benign ones are more common. So the most common actually in my practice now is migraine, psychogenic, and Parkinsonism. These are 3 common causes of central dizziness or vertigo. So we saw already the other day when I gave that talk on the four presentations. So acute vestibular syndrome, recurrent positional vertigo, recurrent non-positional or spontaneous vertigo, and finally chronic imbalance. So when it's not the ear, we have to either think of a balance disorder or central vertigo. So balance disorder is what we'll first briefly talk about. I'm going to take another talk on balance problems later, but just now let us at least briefly go over it. So this is a ENT surgeon's secretary with 5 years of left hearing loss and imbalance. She calls it dizziness. She calls it vertigo, but she was actually feeling loss of balance when walking.
Sir, we can't hear you. Hello.
Where's the finger?
Yeah.
There is an asymmetry. It is much more gross and slower and more coarse on looking to the left. And this is called Bruhn's nystagmus. So this is a combination of vestibular, which takes the eye to one side, and gazebook, that is like a cerebellar. So she's got a combination. Together, if she's getting gazebook, looking asymmetric.
So sorry to interrupt. Hello.
Left.
So this side. My finger. This side.
Finger, please.
Keep looking. Where's the finger?
Here. Yeah.
So when you find an asymmetric gaze evoked nystagmus, if it kept beating to the left, then you would think of a vestibular problem. But it beats to the left when she looks to the left, and when she looks to the right, it changes direction. That suggests a central cause. So this is Bruhn's nystagmus, and she had an acoustic neuroma.
Sir, sorry to interrupt.
Despite being an ENT surgeon's secretary, it was missed. Maybe because you get used to secretaries, particularly old ones. So this is a better Bruhn's nystagmus. Eye is beating left again. Right. Get some more signs. He had a large tumor again in the CP angle tumor region. This is another, a third Bruhn's, and I'm just showing you how to check the cornea. First, bring the cornea down, so you can see it. Right. This was a lady who was sent to me by a psychiatrist. He said she's 1 week, she's unwilling to sit, stand or walk. And this is how she was. Thinking it is psychiatric, her MRI had been done, which was normal, and planters down, reflex normal, everything is normal, but she was not willing to sit. And then, of course, when I saw the eyes, this is what was there.
Can you hear me?
What she's having is opsoclonus. Her eyes are dancing. Actually, it's ocular flutter because it's only in one direction, only horizontal. When you have opsoclonus, it goes in multiple planes, multiple angles. So sometimes down, sometimes up, but conjugate movements. And these are back-to-back saccades. So you cannot do this voluntarily. Her eyes are just moving side to side like a jerk. Now, why is this dangerous? Because it can be paraneoplastic. If it is, very often it is autoimmune and it is a response to steroid, but it may signify that the person has an underlying ovarian or lung cancer. And if it's a child, again, it is dangerous. They can have neuroblastoma. So when you have opsoclonus myoclonus syndrome, be careful, rule out paraneoplastic disorders. This was a lady with 3 months progressive unsteadiness. And when I saw her, these are her eyes. Grossly, it looked normal. Now, when you ask her to look up and down, see what is happening. When she looks up, you can see both the eyes are jerking towards the nose. Now, you have to make the person do a saccade. So when you just do pursuit, you may not see it. But when you say, look up, look down fast, then you can get. Sometimes you can use a tape. So you move a tape downwards and the person will get upbeating saccades. And instead of upbeating, she'll get inwards. One trick that you should see, and I'm going to explain you to see when you are looking at this. So how do you see that both eyes are moving towards each other? Don't look at the eyes. Look at the tikki, the bindi, the between the bridge of her nose. Look at the bridge of her nose, and when you look there, you can still see both eyes, and you'll see the eyes are moving simultaneously towards each other. If you look at one eye, you can't see the other. But if you look at the nose, you can appreciate what is happening. So when you want to see for internuclear ophthalmoplegia, when you want to see for convergence, retraction, nystagmus, look at the bridge of the nose. So she has conversion, retraction, nystagmus, and this is what she had, a Peyronnet's syndrome due to a pineal tumor at the back of the midbrain. This was another lady with funny symptoms. She said she was feeling breathless, she was dizzy, and she would get numb in the head, especially on coughing. And she had a CT scan done, which was normal. And I saw when I examined her, a little bit of vertical eye movement. Carefully now, when you ask her, you can see that combine it with the dizziness and the numbness in the head. She had a large syringe also, which she had not complained about.
Hello.
Young boy with 1 month of unsteadiness. We saw him the other time. 1 month he was going around taking treatment of vertigo, and what he had was actually. Large tumor. This whole white thing is the tumor, and he's having a pontine glioma. Another boy with recent onset of unsteadiness, and he of course complained he is dizzy, but what is happening is when he walks, he was losing balance, and you can see how he walks. He had no finger nose ataxia, there was no nystagmus, but what he had was a Romberg positive, and there was loss of position sense in the legs, and you can see the cause is this subacute combined degeneration. He had a very nice MRI showing the demyelination at the back of the cervical cord.
Hello, sir, can you hear me?
Person with again 6 months imbalance.
Hello.
And when she holds out her hand, again you can see that breast tremor getting worse. This is another boy, his tremor. Often missed if the tremor is absent, if the tremor is subtle, or if it's a young Parkinson and you don't think of Parkinson in that sense. Of course, if the person has tremor, you will think of it. But when the tremor is mild or subtle, and particularly this whole combination, subtle tremor, mild tremor, and young person, then you might miss Parkinson. And God forbid you give these patients Stematil or a drug like that long term, you'll worsen the Parkinson. So elderly with unexplained recurrent falls, everybody knows this is PSP, but I'll just show the eye movements. But why is it called supranuclear? Because when you make the person, when you do a doll's eye movement, the eyes go right up and down, even though they otherwise seem to be frozen. Young girl with 1 month of dizziness. So this girl is, you again now, here you want to see a mild INO. So what you have to do is again look at the bridge of her nose and you will see the two eyes diverge. So when the two eyes are diverge, when they look here and there, the eyes will not normally diverge. But when it diverges, means there is a INO. So look carefully at the bridge of her nose. She's got bilateral INO. When it's not the ear now, we will see the various balance disorders. Then there are various causes of central vertigo. We already saw the other day that vertigo means the person describes clearly either a spinning sensation or a sensation of movement being tilted to one side or bobbing up and down or sliding. Some movement. There is a false sensation of movement. So which are the four? We saw already out of the four chronic imbalance we have ruled out. So now we have to think of acute vestibular syndrome, which is acute vertigo for the first time lasting for more than a few hours. And second is recurrent positional vertigo. I'm not going to talk too much about recurrent positional vertigo because I plan to have a talk on how I approach positional vertigo. And recurrent spontaneous vertigo is what we shall see today. So this is a person, 55-year-old male, diabetes, hypertension. He had three episodes of brief vertigo in the last 2 weeks. So spontaneous attacks of vertigo, each lasting a few minutes. So these are not positional. These were not triggered by getting up or lying or turning in bed. So they are spontaneous attacks of vertigo. No tinnitus, no deafness, no dysarthria, no other symptom. He was given a vestibular suppressants combination and sent home. And 1 week later, he came with
चक्कर आली तेव्हा जीप झड झाली होती.
नाही नाही ऐकलं ते व्यवस्थित बोलत होते. मला ते एकदम व्यवस्थित बोलणे बुधवारी कामावर गेले दिवसभर.
Tell him to. So this is a classic locked-in syndrome. He had basilar occlusion. His initial attacks of vertigo were due to impending basilar occlusion. So be very careful when a person has recurrent attacks of vertigo. This is called an episodic vestibular syndrome. So there are benign causes. Meniere's can cause, migraine can cause, vasovagal syncope or panic attacks can cause. But the serious ones are vertebrobasilar TIA, hypoglycemia and cardiac arrhythmia. Yes, even all of these, the lower three are dangerous causes of dizziness and they will be episodic dizziness. So the person doesn't have to say that he's got spinning rotatory vertigo. Hypoglycemia won't get that, but he will feel dizzy. Cardiac arrhythmia, myocardial infarct can cause vertigo, actual spinning sensation. And the reason given is possibly that the vestibular cerebellum is more prone to ischemia. So when somebody gets hypotension, when somebody gets a myocardial infarct or an arrhythmia, he may get vertigo. So we earlier used to think that somebody with postural hypotension should only say, I'm feeling faint, I feel I might pass out. He should not get spinning attacks. But Dr. David Newman Toker has clearly shown that a high number of such patients with cardiac or vascular causes can get actual rotatory vertigo. So when you get isolated vertigo due to TIA, the earlier teaching was that you cannot get earlier. I remember when I was a student, Harrison clearly said, if you get only vertigo attacks more than 2 weeks, no diplopia, no dysarthria, no other central symptom, then it has to be an ear problem and you can relax. And that has been proved wrong now. There are documented cases for months, patient is getting only vertigo, no other symptom, and later testing or because he gets an attack of, or gets a stroke, later on we find that it was all due to vertebrobasilar insufficiency. So this can be a TIA and be very careful. Now the dangerous one here is the ICA territory, because ICA territory is the anterior inferior cerebellar artery is peculiar. It supplies the labyrinth, that is the inner ear, and it supplies the midbrain and the cerebellum. So you can get tinnitus, you can get hearing loss, you can get cerebellar or brainstem stroke. So when somebody says, I'm feeling dizzy and he complains of tinnitus and deafness, you are going to say Meniere's or some ear problem, but it could be an ICA territory infarct, ICA territory TIA. And if you miss it, he may get a stroke. So when somebody comes with this combination, recurrent attacks of vertigo, be careful. If the attacks, Meniere's, to diagnose Meniere's, you have to have a clear history. The attack has to last more than 20 minutes. There is a peculiar pattern of hearing loss. There is a peculiar maybe fullness in the ear. If you have everything and if the attacks are really more than 20 minutes, then call it meniere's. Most of the time, a TIA lasts for a few minutes. So if you get attacks of vertigo lasting for a few minutes spontaneous, even if the person has hearing loss or tinnitus during, don't relax, it could be a TIA. And even if it is going on for months, it could be a TIA. So then somebody has a central cause and you have diplopia. These are called the deadly D's. I've borrowed this slide from David Newman Toker. So if you have the deadly D's, diplopia, dysarthria, dysphagia, dysphonia, dysesthesia, then of course you think of a brainstem lesion. But like I showed in that patient, you may not get any brainstem lesion. Where peripheral versus central, this sometimes you can use this. If the person has less vertigo and more of ataxia, that may suggest central. If there is no other symptom, that may, the nystagmus patterns are different. In peripheral, the person looks more sick. He often has nausea, vomiting, severe vertigo, but less of ataxia. So ear symptoms may be there, but not always. Vestibular neuritis may not have any ear symptoms at all. But the nystagmus pattern will be different. It will be only one direction nystagmus in peripheral causes. And in central, it can be one direction. Then you have to use the Hintz protocol, as we shall see. But many times, the gaze evoked nystagmus or Bruhn's nystagmus or upbeating or downbeating, that will help you. So there is ways of distinguishing. We won't go into it. Which are the patterns of central nystagmus? If it is not one side, in peripheral, you will get unidirectional one-sided beating. When you have anything which is not that, think of a central cause. So dizziness in vertebrobacillary insufficiency is very important. It can be the only isolated symptoms for weeks or months. Again, I'm telling it because this is often missed. And if you miss it and the person gets a locked-in syndrome or a major basilar stroke, it could be really bad. So this slide we've already seen. So episodic vertigo, when it is less than 24 hours, the benign causes, if there's tinnitus or deafness, the benign causes meniere's. And the dangerous cause is an ICA territory TIA. And when the person has no tinnitus or deafness, but only attacks of vestibular of vertigo for a few minutes, your most common cause is vestibular migraine. And this can be sometimes happen in a PICA territory TIA. So essentially, you have to remember two dangerous causes of recurrent brief attacks of vertigo. A TIA either in the ICA territory where they may have tinnitus or deafness also, or a TIA in the PICA territory where there is no tinnitus, deafness, only vertigo. And the non-dangerous causes, the more common ones are vestibular migraine and meniere's. And there is a huge overlap between the two. We'll take that sometime later. You cannot really distinguish between vestibular migraine and meniere's except if you show a progressive hearing loss later. So many people feel that they are just the same thing. There are lots of common things between them and most tests cannot distinguish. Then we come to the acute vestibular syndrome when the attack of vertigo is lasting more than 24 hours. So it's no longer a TIA. So here the dangerous one is a stroke. Same way, either ICA territory stroke or a PICA territory stroke. And here you might think of either labyrinthitis when there is tinnitus or deafness along with the vertigo, or vestibular neuritis where there is no hearing symptom, only vertigo. And this AVS, that is acute vestibular syndrome, from history, there are some points which may tell you, which may warn you that this may not be acute vestibular neuritis. So if the person has multiple prodromal attacks, he gets vertigo just for a few minutes, feels dizzy, and then one day he gets an attack which lasts for 24 hours. Be careful. Vestibular neuritis does not get prodromal attacks. Secondly, if it is very abrupt, if he says, I woke up in the morning, had tea, everything was all right, and suddenly I started getting vertigo, that is unlikely to be vestibular neuritis. It could be a stroke. Again, if you have disproportionate vomiting or gait, if the person cannot walk, he's saying he's grossly imbalanced, that is a point in favor of stroke. If there's pain, either neck, that may suggest dissection. And if there's headache, again, that is not seen in vestibular neuritis. The fifth one, that is a little tricky. If along with the vertigo, person says, suddenly I am not hearing well from today. Most people might feel relaxed. Okay, he's got hearing loss and vertigo. No. If it is a first time sudden attack of vertigo with hearing loss, most of the times it's going to be a stroke and it's an ICA territory infarct. So viral illnesses, vestibular neuritis or labyrinthitis, you will get acute onset hearing loss. If you get sudden hearing loss, it is unlikely to be vascular. It is more likely viral. If you get sudden vertigo, it is more likely to be vestibular neuritis. But if you get vertigo and deafness suddenly, it is not ear, it is mostly brain. It is an AIC, ICA territory infarct. And of course, if you get new neurological symptoms, so if there is dysarthria or some other symptom, diplopia along with the vertigo, then it's not AVS, it is a stroke. So stroke, the number of strokes can cause this, cerebellar bleeds, infarcts, or pica territory and ICA territory infarcts. Again, I'm repeating, ICA territory may present only with deafness or hearing loss or tinnitus. And cerebellar infarcts, as you know, can be dangerous, can need urgent surgery, and can get the person might get a massive brainstem stroke like we saw locked-in syndrome. So you have to be careful. The MRI can be normal initially in stroke. So this is a lateral medullary infarct, 8 hours and even 3 days after, 8 hours after the stroke, nothing. And then second MRI after 3 days is a tiny lateral medullary infarct. So remember, again, another golden rule, when you suspect a possible stroke in the posterior fossa, just because the scan, MRI is 3D or something and it's normal does not mean you're okay. Just because MR angio is normal does not mean you're okay. You must repeat a scan at 72 hours. And sometimes only after 72 hours, you will see the infarct. So this is a slide explaining why you get head impulse absent. So this is the vestibular ocular reflex. The impulse goes from the inner ear. It follows, goes along the vestibular ganglion and it goes to the brainstem and moves the ear, eyes to the appropriate side. So here is 8th in and 6th and 3rd. So the eyes move to the side, therefore 6th and 3rd are involved. Now, if you have a lesion, say vestibular neuritis, when there's vestibular neuritis and you move the head, this impulse is not going to go. So you are going to get head impulse absent. But when you have a cerebellar stroke, it is here. It is here. This pathway is intact. So in cerebellar stroke, the head impulse test is normal. So a normal head impulse test is dangerous. If you have an abnormal head impulse test, it is likely to be vestibular neuritis. But there are some cases. So suppose there's a stroke here affecting this pathway. So lateral brainstem infarct, lateral pontine, lateral medullary infarct can sometimes catch these fibers and you will get head impulse absent. You will feel this is vestibular neuritis and you may miss it. So lateral pontine stroke can affect. So if you get direction changing nystagmus, so this is direction when he looks to the left, like the patient we saw with Bruns, when the person is looking to the left, gross nystagmus, when he looks to the right, little bit nystagmus. This little bit is important. And again, I've borrowed a slide from Dr. David. So this is a patient where he's showing definite nystagmus on looking to the left. And you may think it's vestibular neuritis. At rest, beating to the left, when he looks to the left, it is much more gross. See what happens when he looks to the right. It changes direction very subtly. You have to be careful and watch it. But that gives it away. If the patient, see there, you can see that when he looks to the right, you're getting nystagmus beating to the right. And that means it is not an ear problem. Skew deviation, you have seen earlier, but again, I'll show you, it's very easy to see. You don't need this plastic thing. You can just use your fingers like this. So what you are doing is ask the patient to keep looking at your nose and see where his eyes are. Whether you cover the eye or not, this eye should also be looking at the same spot. So when I uncover it, this eye is still looking there and you should not see any movement. But if the eyes are like this, when one eye is covered, this eye is looking here, but that eye is looking there. When I cover this one, then he has to bring it down from up. So if you see this up-down movement when you cover and uncover, that means the person has a skew deviation. So another trick to remember, don't look at the eyes, whether they are going up and down. Look at the eyelid. Many times the eyelid tells more easily whether the eye is going up and down. If the eye goes up, the eyelid goes up. So that is seen more easily. So in this patient, look at the eyelid. Sit down, goes up, up. Which means when you cover, uncover it, goes up, means that the right eye is lower and the left eye is higher. So this is called left hypertropia. You say which is the higher eye, the left eye is higher. So left hypertropia. So this is skew deviation. So these three subtle signs, direction changing nystagmus is found in about 20% cases of stroke. Skew deviation is found in about 25%. Head impulse, 93%. But if you do only head impulse, that means in 7% cases, you might miss a stroke. So only one sign if you go by, it's not good enough. If you say, I'm only going to look for direction changing nystagmus, then 80% of strokes you will miss because it's only in 20%. If you look only for skew deviation, you will find it only in 25%. So 75% strokes you will miss if you see only skew deviation. If you do only head impulse, you will pick up in much more, 93%, 7% you will miss. But if you do all three, that is 100% sensitive and maybe 96%. So this is the best test. MRI is 88% sensitive. So 12% MRIs can be normal. Therefore, these three signs, which you can do in 5 minutes, can tell you immediately whether the person has a stroke or not. And if you see these signs, you should be able to be sure enough. If the person is not able to walk and you get these signs, you should be able to be confident enough to thrombolyze this patient and not wait for an MRI to become abnormal after sometimes 72 hours. You may find the MRI normal and you may lose the opportunity to thrombolyze. Central positional vertigo now, I'm not going to talk much about it except to tell you that not all positional vertigo is BPPV. And if you find atypical features, so if you find nystagmus without much of vertigo, or if you find different patterns of nystagmus, or if you find other central symptoms, or fourthly, you try repositioning and it just doesn't seem to work. When you have really properly tried repositioning and it's not working, think of a central cause. We'll go into central positional vertigo when I talk about positional vertigo. So we come to the end. The take-home points are always think of central causes. 1 in 4 can be central, especially if there's no tinnitus or deafness. But even if there is, be careful. Watch out for unprovoked vertigo lasting minutes. That is possibly a TIA. And unsteadiness is not usually an ear problem. You can get imbalance in certain ear diseases, which we'll see when I talk about imbalance. Bilateral vestibulopathy can cause imbalance. But otherwise, in general, ear disease causes vertigo and not imbalance. And look carefully at the eyes in dizzy patient. Look whether he's got convergent nystagmus. See whether there's a mild INO. I didn't show that patient where there's a very subtle INO. Mild INO can tell you that this is a central cause. Look for direction changing nystagmus. Look for asymmetric Bruin's nystagmus or downbeating nystagmus. So look carefully at the eyes. And of course, head impulse is a very important test which you have to look at. Thank you. Okay, so somebody was supposed to take the question, but I'll only look at the questions and see. Dr. Vikas Agarwal is asking, is the topic changed? Yes, of course, I'm not talking on epilepsy. It got changed because the speaker could not come. Oh, so somebody's written he couldn't hear my voice while playing the video. Actually, I had stopped the video sound. Oh no, I'm sorry. So many people have said that I had stopped the sound, but it looks like it had it is stopped on my side. Yes, Dr. Mangesh Udar is telling us about ruptured ectopic pregnancy. That is one more cause of postural hypotension. So it can present as postural hypotension in a lady with amenorrhea because again, there's bleeding which is not seen outside. I'm really sorry about the sound. I didn't switch it off and I wish somebody had told me, but anyway. And I had lots of videos. Yeah. So the only question is that. Okay. Corneal reflex, Dr. Biswa Kumar from Chennai is saying, it's a comment, not a question. What he says is corneal reflex is better tested by bringing a wisp of cotton standing behind the patient and bringing the wisp from the side rather than from the front to avoid the avoidance reflex. Yes, basically the patient should not see that. So what I do is from behind, it will be difficult for me. What I do is tell the patient to look up and bring it from down so he does not see. So the basic point is the patient should not see the thing coming straight at him because then he's going to blink. Okay, I don't think there are any other questions. The only thing is mute the video. So I'm sorry. Somebody is asking if 1 in 4 vertigos are dangerous, isn't it safer to image patients? No, 1 in 4 vertigo is not dangerous. 1 in 4 vertigo is central. Not all causes of central vertigo are dangerous. The commonest cause of central vertigo is migraine and what is called triple PD. So the persistent postural dizziness. So commonest is not a dangerous cause. But yes, when you have a sudden onset first time vertigo, then up to 1 in 4 out of those could be a stroke. And it is not safer to image, because imaging alone will not give you the answer. You must learn to do the HINTS protocol. Is there any risk factor for basilar occlusion in episodic vascular syndrome? Yes, so basilar occlusion, the person which I showed you came with Lockton syndrome did have diabetes and hypertension, but not always you will get that. So the person, the young boy who came with acute vertigo initially and then came with a stroke in the, his risk factor was homocysteine was high. So he didn't have diabetes, hypertension or any other routine risk factor. Somebody is asking me about what about MCA stroke affecting the vestibular cortex. So I have never seen a MCA stroke present with vertigo. Theoretically, it is possible. I have seen seizures presenting as vertigo, but then you see a very typical, if you can see during the attack, you can see one direction eyes beating just jerkily suddenly to one side. And seizure is a rare cause of vertigo, but you have to keep it in mind. So Dr. Anirban Biswas from Kolkata, he asked how to confirmatively diagnose TIA, any investigation, how to treat. So to diagnose TIA, if you get recurrent attacks of spontaneous vertigo in a person, particularly, you know, what are the causes of recurrent attacks of spontaneous vertigo? It could be a TIA, it could be migraine. That is the most common, but there are some other causes also. So if the person has recurrent attacks lasting for a few minutes, then you should think of a TIA. And if he's got a particular age group particularly, or if he's got risk factors like diabetes hypertension, then you must do a good MR angio. MRI will be normal in a TIA, as you know, because the brain is not yet infarcted. Can we thrombolyze in posterior circulation? Of course we can. In fact, in the posterior circulation, the stroke specialist here will tell us that the window is probably bigger. You can thrombolyze a little later because probably does not, there's less risk of hemorrhagic conversion. And so therefore you definitely can thrombolyze. When you thrombolyze, again, you can't go by the NIHSS because the NIHSS misses, is not really loaded. It is loaded towards the anterior circulation. So you have to see how badly the patient is disabled. A Wallenberg, the person may have dysphagia for 2 months. Wallenberg, the person may be grossly ataxic. And Wallenberg may be left behind with a lot of sensory burning pain. So Wallenberg syndrome is definitely something that can be thrombolyzed. And posterior fossa stroke, if the person comes with a stroke and you do the HINTS protocol, he's got sudden attack of vertigo, head impulse is negative, or he's got skew deviation, or he's got direction changing nystagmus, go ahead, this is likely to be a stroke. Would I recommend MRI in every case of sensory neural hearing loss, acute or chronic? No, it's not really necessary, but if it is an acute sensory neural hearing loss, if it's only hearing loss, as I said, it is likely to be viral and you are likely to find a normal MRI. But if it is vertigo plus sensory hearing loss, then I would recommend not MRI, but MR angio also, because you have to look at the ICA territory. Can we thrombolyze? Again, somebody asked, yes. What's the treatment of persisting vertigo in the posterior circulation stroke? So vertigo usually will not persist, imbalance will persist. And you will need vestibular rehab later on for these patients with a cerebellar stroke or a brainstem stroke who has the treatment is not drugs. So what is the time duration to cover the eye while testing for skew? So I will just show it like you are. I'm looking at you there and I'm looking here. See what is happening to the eye. Immediately go there. See. So I am still looking here and luckily I don't have any skew. But if I had skew, what would happen is I'll do this. So I'll go here and when I'm bringing it up. So I'm changing my eye up and down when I cover and uncover. So Dr. Duberkar asks, sir, what if we thrombolyze and MRI remains negative, medico-legal issues? So tell me, Dr. Dhananjay, if a patient came with a TIA in the, or a early stroke in the MCA territory, and you thrombolyze him and the MRI is normal, you will be happy. But because you are not sure, happy, see, you should tell them that, look, I prevented an infarct. You have to be that confident. You have to document those signs. If you are doing a head impulse, you're doing a skew, take a video and keep it and save it. Because if you are going to thrombolize, you will need documentation. Dr. Bhatia, Dr. Rupinder Singh Bhatia asks, on day one of vertigo, many patients do not cooperate for examination of vertigo, of nystagmus because of fear of vertigo. How safe we can be in not doing MRI brain? I'm not saying not doing, but you're not safe in doing MRI brain. I'm not saying that don't do an MRI. When somebody comes with an acute vertigo, do the MRI. It reassures them, it reassures you also. But just because MRI is normal does not mean it is not a stroke. So you have, there's no shortcut. You have to examine the eyes. How common is superior semicircular canal dehiscence? I've seen only one case till now. It is not common. Maybe Dr. Biswas might tell us how common it is. It's an uncommon cause. The person comes with hearing problems. The person may have a conductive hearing loss. If you do his VEMPs, you'll find very large VEMPs. And the person may have a very peculiar symptom. You put a tuning fork on his leg and he feels it in the ear. Or when he coughs, or if there's a loud noise, he may feel vertigo. So I have been waiting to pick up patients of dehiscence, but no, patients don't really come. It's not too common. How to treat vertigo of central origin depends on the cause. So you have to first diagnose. If it is a stroke or a TI, you treat that. If it is a migraine, you treat that. Depending on what is the cause, you treat. How commonly have you seen ICA infarct with only hearing loss and vertigo as presentation? It is rare, of course. So the person is saying, I feel it is rare. But rare does not mean it doesn't happen. There are n number of case presentations and case reports where person came with only hearing loss. If you take a person with ICA territory infarct, he will have had just hearing loss or vertigo as symptoms before. So TIA-like symptoms he would have had. And if a person comes with an infarct later and he had shown you earlier, you could be liable for you know, medical legal things. ICA in ISC causing peripheral vestibulopathy. I didn't understand. What are the clues towards autoimmune vestibulopathy? Okay, interesting question. So I have seen a few patients with autoimmune, I might show those cases later, where the person keeps getting, normally vestibular neuritis is a one-time attack. But if you get repeated attacks of what looks like vestibular neuritis, and you can clearly show repeated attacks of vestibular neuritis or bilateral vestibular neuritis or bilateral attacks, then you should think of autoimmune disorder. None of the autoimmune tests are positive, and I have some patients, I will show them sometime later, where they had repeated attacks of vestibular neuritis. Finally, I had to give the person rituximab. I gave steroids, I gave IVIG, he would respond. Again, after 2 months, he would come back with an attack. So we gave rituximab and now he's not had any attacks. So this is off-label. Nobody has got such patients, and I had asked some people, but we couldn't find. Recurrent unexplained vertigo, is there any role of prolonged Holter monitoring? I wouldn't think so. Only vertigo for the to be presenting as the cause of cardiac arrhythmia would be very, very rare. So otherwise you'll end up doing unnecessarily too many tests. How often do you see absent corneal reflex in vertigo due to CP angle tumors? Dr. Anirudh Apte from Surat asks, how often do you see absent? I find, if you see a CP angle tumor, the next thing, this has been taught to me by Dr. R.S. Wadia when I was in MBBS, that when a CP angle tumor, it starts typically in the vestibular. So first thing that will go is head impulse. You start feeling a little dizzy, not attacks of vertigo typically. Then next, they will start losing hearing. As the tumor goes out, then the next thing that is caught is a corneal. So corneal reflex is early. When it grows bigger, then you'll get six nerve palsy. And when it grows even bigger, then you may get six nerve or cerebellar signs. So cerebellar signs are not too common in CP angle tumors. Before that, you'll get corneal reflex absent. Evaluation and treatment of tinnitus, if ENT ruled out, tinnitus is something bad. Most of the times, we also can't find anything tinnitus. Rarely, there may be a dural AVF or something, and you might pick it up. I was very lucky once with orthopedic surgeon friend of mine who came to me with headache and tinnitus, and I, for what reason, I don't know, I put a stetho on his ear and I could hear a loud brewing, and we picked up a dural AVF. But that it's not common. So if somebody has only tinnitus, no hearing loss, it's very difficult to find out the cause. Often it is psychogenic, but it's tough. Hydrocephalus attack versus vertigo from stroke. I am not understood. I am sorry. When will you do MRI in BPPV? When the patient wants it and he's not happy. If I cure his BPPV and he still wants, that's his problem. The person comes to me with vertigo and I treat it and it's gone. Why should he want an MRI? But we'll talk about positional vertigo later. Dr. Abhinay Huche asked me, what do you use for vestibular migraine? I want to give a talk on vestibular migraine because my thoughts about it are quite different than most people. What I use for vestibular migraine is what I use for migraine. So you do the same thing. You advise lifestyle modification. You advise regular sleep, exercise, eating properly. So lifestyle is important. Try to find out, is there any stressor, and address that. And then if you really have to give drugs, if the person is getting one attack in a month, or two attacks in a month, just as somebody with headache due to migraine, if you get two attacks a month, you don't give prophylactic therapy. You only give SOS, NSAID or naproxen or whatever. Same way, if somebody is getting vestibular migraine, one or two attacks in a month, why give anything? Just let him take Strugeron, Stemetil or whatever drug you want to give, SOS, only one tablet SOS when he gets the attack. Don't continue it for weeks and months. When you do have to give some prophylactic, he's getting frequent attacks, then I would give a prophylactic drug. I prefer SSRIs, but that some people prefer anticonvulsants in migraine. Some people prefer flunarizine. Some people prefer propranolol. There are no studies to show what is better. You use what works for you. Then, should we do ECG in all vertigos? Not necessarily. Role of migraine prophylactic, I already told you. When one is strongly thinking of posterior circulation stroke, what we should advise to the radiographer? Tell him that I'm thinking of a posterior, take very thin cuts of the posterior fossa and look carefully at the MR angio to look for a dissection of the vertebral or affection of the vertebral or basilar. Dr. Abhinay Huche asked me, do you prescribe vertiginous medicines? I don't, and that's why the vertigo drug companies do not like me. Not only do I not prescribe, but I stop other people's prescriptions. If I do prescribe, I give it in, say, something like I told you, somebody having migraine and he gets one attack or two attacks in a month, I give him an SOS tablet. Take SOS only when needed, and that is the only time I advise. Second reason when I advise drugs is if somebody comes with vestibular neuritis, he's got severe nausea, vomiting, I give it for 3 days, not more than 3 days. And for BPPV, I don't give before or after treating BP. I don't give any drugs. I only give in BPPV. We'll talk about it when I am talking about drugs. If the person is out of town, if he cannot see me, he cannot come for repositioning, then he has no choice. Take the tablet. Kushal Agarwal asked me, please share experience in thrombolysis of posterior circulation stroke. I will show a case where I had thrombolyzed, and as Dhananjay said, what if the MRI came normal? The MRI didn't come normal. It showed a small, tiny hemorrhagic infarct in the cerebellum. So his infarct became hemorrhagic, but it was very tiny. But that showed that there was something, and there was an infarct which became hemorrhagic. But this patient did come to me with an acute onset vertigo, and the head impulse was negative. Dr. Rohiwal asks, apart, he's an ENT surgeon, apart from dangerous Ds, what to look for when patient is seen in casualty? So when the patient is seen in casualty means this is an acute vestibular syndrome, first attack of sudden severe vertigo. So if you have dangerous Ds, obviously it is CNS wrong. Even if you don't have dangerous Ds, you must follow the HINTS Plus protocol. And this is such an important topic that I'm going to keep one talk by a South American doctor, Dr. Sergio Carmona, who will talk to us about the acute vestibular syndrome in the casualty. So how to distinguish, you must know, even if it's repeatedly we are doing head impulse, skew deviation, and direction changing nystagmus. That is the HINTS protocol, but HINTS Plus is where you add hearing also. So you read up about HINTS Plus protocol. We will have a talk on that again. So dangerous vertigo is something you just can't afford to miss. Acute vertigo, when to get MRI brain, immediate or after 72 hours? Of course, you have to do it immediately. But before you send the patient home, if you have to be sure it was not an infarct, then you may have to repeat at 72 hours. So just do a flare axial at 72 hours. You don't have to repeat the MR angio, but do a limited section. Maybe get it done, at least in Pune in concession, I get it done in 1500 or 2000, just one section. So can you see, somebody's asking, can you see direction changing nystagmus in migraine? Yes. So we'll talk about migraine later. In migraine, you can get all sorts of nystagmus. Explain Brun's nystagmus. I told you, it's a gaze evoked nystagmus. When he looks to the right, it beats to the right. When he looks to the left, it beats to the left. But it's not symmetric. When he looks to the right, it's more coarse. And when he looks here, it is smaller. So the lesion is on the side of the coarser nystagmus, on the right side. In which situation HINT Plus protocol should be done? In every situation where the person comes with sudden onset of severe vertigo, first time attack of vertigo, do the HINTS protocol. Somebody is asking again, if first time people do not want to thrombolyze, the posterior circulation looks like. So if first time basilar migraine, TI and seizure have similar presentation as stroke, how wise is it to thrombolyze? You have to see your signs. So if first time basilar migraine, somebody has never had migraine in the past and now comes with a first time severe attack of, I do not accept it as migraine. If the person is having repeated attacks, then I will call it migraine. So migraine, I would not worry. TIA, again, I would not thrombolyze a TIA in the posterior circulation if the angio is normal. And even if the angio is normal, I would not thrombolyze a TIA. A seizure obviously looks different when he comes to me in front of me. If the person has an acute vascular vestibular syndrome, that means he's having nystagmus now, he's having vertigo now, he's having ataxia now in front of me. That is an acute vestibular syndrome, and that is which one I will thrombolyze. If somebody came to me with a history that I get attacks of vertigo at home, like seizure or TIA, no question of thrombolysis. You don't thrombolyze a TIA in either anterior circulation or posterior circulation. Prolonged vertigo, oscillopsia with downbeating, gaze evoked nystagmus with normal MRIs multiple times. Should one think of vestibular migraine? Yes, I would think of vestibular migraine. Somebody's written PSG class. I don't understand. Do drugs help for symptom control of central vertigo along with treating the cause, e.g. antiplatelets for ischemic stroke? If the person has vertigo, when somebody comes with a lateral medullary infarct and he's having severe vertigo and spinning, give it for a couple of days, just a few days. If you continue the drugs later on, after a week or so, then you are not doing the person good. You have to start vestibular rehab for such patients later on. So you give it when the person is vomiting, has severe vertigo initially. So all drugs, whether you give it for stroke or vestibular neuritis, not more than 3 or 4 days. What are common supratentorial causes? Supratentorial causes do not commonly cause vertigo. Holter, I would. What about comments on otolithic crisis? So otolithic crisis, I've seen only once or twice. These are patients who have what looks like typical meniere. So the patient has attacks of vertigo lasting more than 20 minutes. He often has a fluctuating hearing loss. He has a fluctuating tinnitus and may have fullness in the ear. So the fluctuating is important. And you have to document progressive hearing loss. Somebody just has history of past history and long-standing hearing loss and now comes with attacks of vertigo lasting 1 or 2 minutes. That is not the triad or the tetrad. You have to have vertigo more than 20 minutes. So sometimes such patients get what is called an otolithic crisis, where suddenly the person falls to the ground. As you know, the otolith organ has to do with linear movement. The semicircular canals tell us when the head is moving to the right or left. But the otolith tells us whether you are going up or down in a lift or front or back in a car. So when there is an otolithic disturbance, suddenly the person may feel tilted to the one side or may straight away fall to the ground. Most of the time, whenever the two patients that I saw of otolithic crisis, when they fall to the ground, they complain that things are spinning. And they do have attacks of vertigo, which are like meniere's otherwise. So somebody who just falls to the ground, that is a drop attack. That is not otolithic crisis. ICA loop in internal auditory canal causing peripheral vestibulopathy. Be very careful. Dr. Ketan Chudasama has asked this. Just as for this loop causing anything, you have to be very careful because normal neurovascular compression is seen in many normal people and it is often seen bilateral. So just finding the artery touching which the MRI people, so when you send for MRI and you say vertigo, they look at the posterior fossa very carefully and they will point out that there is some neurovascular compression. Don't try to operate such patients. How to treat chronic dizziness of Parkinson's patients? These patients are imbalanced. So you treat the Parkinson's appropriately with drugs and you give them gait and vestibular rehab, gait rehabilitation. Give them exercises for improving their balance. So vertigo in acephalgic migraine, yes, vertigo occurs in migraine. We'll talk about migraine sometime later. Benign paroxysmal vertigo of infancy, it is a migraine. So again, we'll take in the migraine talk. It is. Should we do USG abdomen in child with vertigo? Why? No, I wouldn't do. How will ultrasound help? I cannot think. My take on Lobazam. Lobazam is an excellent anticonvulsant, clobazam that means. It's good as an anti-anxiety drug, so you may use it for that, but I don't use it for vertigo. How do I treat Meniere's? Dose of beta histine and how long? Okay, so Dr. Dattan Adgir is asking, I have very radical ideas on Meniere's. I feel most of the patients who come to me with Meniere's are migraine and I treat them as migraine and they respond. So I do not treat them with beta histine. As you know, the BMED trial, the trial was published in the BMJ. It was done by no one else apart from then Dr. Michael Stroup, the person who advises you to give beta histine. So he, when initially they were advising us to give 8 milligrams thrice a day for many years. Then they showed it's not helping, so they came out with 16 mg thrice a day. Then they've come out with 48 mg thrice a day. So now you give 48 milligrams thrice a day. Then what were you doing when you were giving 8 milligrams? I don't know. Secondly, the BMED trial has shown that even 48 milligrams thrice a day is as good as placebo. And this is a trial done by the same investigators. Dr. Michael Stroup is the main investigator for the BMED trial. And that shows that it doesn't work. It is as good as placebo. So beta histine does not work. Now, if you say, do you treat headache with crocin or you give a suppressant drug like let's say naproxen. If I'm getting an occasional attack of headache, if I keep taking it for 3 months, I'll not get headache. That is not treatment. So has the natural history been shown to be changed? When you're taking beta histine 48 or 100 milligrams thrice a day, you will not feel vertigo. But what happens when you stop it? Again, you are going to get, they have not shown that you take a course for 6 months and then you are okay for life. For those 6 months, you will not find. So you are banishing a person for lifelong beta histine therapy. So don't treat many years with beta histine. When Dr. Vinit Banga asked, just a comment, when suspecting posterior circulation stroke, ask the tech to keep the VO till lower down medulla. Yes, right. So you have to, when they're taking the sections, see the lowest part of the medulla because, and sometimes only coronal sections might show that small lateral medullary infarct. So you have to tell the technician that look carefully at the medulla, look carefully at the brainstem. I'm suspecting a brainstem stroke and they often miss it. So you have to tell the technician. I think that is the last question. Yeah. Okay, thank you. And I'm sorry that we had to cancel the talk and get this in between. And I will answer your questions on positional vertigo and migraine and many years when I talk about it later. Thank you. Good night.